Thank you very much for that lovely introduction. Thank you all for being here, even if you were required to be here. I hope you might come again voluntarily at some point to another reading. And I hope that you don't cringe too much during the reading today. I'm trying to balance things out. I know some of you in classes have been reading work from various places, so I'm going to kind of jump around and read poems and actually a short story as well to just give you a kind of sampling of my work. And I'm already varying from my plan. I thought I would read Factory Love, the poem that's on the roof of a race car. Not a NASCAR race car, but nevertheless, that guy's name was Alex Grabeau, and he emailed me out of the blue and said, "Hey, can I put your poem on the roof of my race car?" And the reason he wanted to do it, he said, is that all of us car guys really love our cars, or love our machines. And the poem I'm going to read to you is a love poem for a machine I worked in the factory, one of the machines. And he identified with it in that way. And I think, as writers, we're all trying to connect to whoever we can connect to, however we can connect. And so this is my biggest thrill as a writer is to have my poem on the roof of that car. The poem is set, I suspect not many of you have worked in factories and have no desire to, but you may have done shift work before. And shift work is where you know the place stays open and somebody takes over your job and works another shift. And maybe you can identify with this idea that you come in and the place is messed up by the person you're replacing. And if you're working a lot of overtime, you might even get a little jealous of the person manipulating your machine, as I do in this poem called Factory Love. Machine, I've come to you 800 times a day like a crazy monkey lover, in and out, in and out, in and out. And you hardly ever break down, such clean welds, such sturdy parts. Oh, how I love to oil your tips. Machine, please come home with me tonight. I'll scrub off all the stains on your name, grease and graffiti. I'm tired of being your part-time lover. Let me carry you off into the night on a high love. That guy at midnight's, I know he drinks and beats you. So a little bit too much overtime there. So just in terms of my, you know, there's a kind of poem called the Ars Poetica, where it's about the art of poetry that's been a long tradition. And when I think of, you know, where my poems are coming from, they're coming from my background and my family experience. So I'm just going to read you a part of this poem called Turning Down the Ars Poetica, Heating Up the Leftovers, which I think might have been inspired by the poet William Stafford, who when asked what his biggest influence was as a writer, he said, "The sound of my mother's voice." Somewhere a man arrives home from work in streetlight darkness, car door etching itself on the street's silence. Inside, leftovers on the stove, a woman in her robe prepares his plate. Five children asleep, radio tuned to talk on health and home improvement and religion, though it's just soft static now as she sits down to watch him eat, as he sits down to hear what he missed. I can't tell you whether they even hug or kiss before collapsing in the bed together, for I am already in dream's tender arms. And if this violates point of view or logic, she'll get you a plate and explain it all to you, my mother. Because that's really my childhood, is my father working a lot of overtime and this kind of absence that you might hear while you're laying in bed asleep. Now I want to read you a short story that blends into poetry, I think. It's called 13-Part Story with Mine, and there's a famous poem by Wallace Stevens called 13 Ways of Looking at a Blackbird, and it's just the variations on a theme. There's no blackbirds in this. But this story combines two of the major things in my life, which are the factory and the university, because I've been teaching for a long time. The name of this college has been changed to protect the innocent or guilty. And you can follow along, because there is indeed 13 sections. Oh, and if you don't know anything about mimes, you may consider yourself fortunate, but one of the main mime tricks is to pretend that you, am I doing okay up there? Okay. Pretend that you're in a box, right? And so that'll come up later. One, she was an artist, and hadn't I always wanted to fall in love with an artist? No, not always, but recently, yes. Since I signed on for the college thing to avoid joining my father on the Elkie shift at Ford. At Black Swamp U, I quickly noticed the women in their tight, faded, paint-stained jeans, their breasts free and loose beneath their blouses because it was 1977. But she was a mime. Back home in Toledo, I'd walk the extra block to avoid the mimes outside the art museum. Until the city council passed Municipal Code Ordinance 757, which states that mimes are not artists and exile them to cornfields and empty high school football stadiums. I'd heard that one of the mime buskers had won the coveted position of Muddy Mudhen, the Toledo Mudhens AAA baseball team mascot. Muddy wore these ratty yellow tights with his leg hairs poking through. He spent his time in the expensive seats with the children of Toledo's medium rolling season ticket holders. Toledo had no high rollers, at least any that show up at Mudhens games. But then I noticed one particular female mime in tights, and that was a whole different ball game. So I came to love her big old surprise, even when she was out of makeup. She thought I looked like one of the Doobie Brothers. I didn't like the Doobie Brothers. They were not real brothers, I explained. Then she gave me that, oh. Now that's another big mime thing, the oh surprise, where you go. Two, they put a mustache on her and she looked like Hitler or Charlie Chaplin playing Hitler. The mime troupe, T-R-O-U-P-E, not T-R-O-O-P, she corrected me, was called Contradiction. The mime director could not shut up off stage. He had a guru complex, and the young fledgling mimes hovered around him like he was the Swami of mimes. I suspect he had no formal training, but at that small college in the middle of the Black Swamp region of Ohio, he could have said he was Marcel Marceau, and nobody would have winked or blinked. He was a French professor, though. I'm not sure I even had to tell you that. Three. We met because you could not help meeting every single person at Black Swamp U, a tiny square of buildings surrounded by cornfields. We were like midgets, and the cornfields were a redwood forest. It was flatter than flat. It was below sea level flat, and we were all slowly sinking in the muck. But you could maintain the illusion of staying afloat because the drinking age was 18, lower if you were French or Polish or Italian or rectangular or, well, forget the Irish. I was Irish and weaned on beer and cigarettes. Smoking was still good in 1977, at least semi-okay, especially with artists. The last smokers on earth will be two poets, three painters, a folk singer, and a mime who stayed alive by pretending to smoke. The student union served beer, coffee, and cherry Tootsie Roll Pops because the artist pretended to love them. I bought her a beer and a sucker one night and told her I was a poet. An English major, I figured I could fake it. Hell, I'd read enough of this shit. But she wasn't going to sleep with me unless I shared my words with her, so I started writing them down. She would take me to her broom closet studio. We would smoke cigarettes and think great thoughts and blow great artistic smoke rings. Oh. Four. I think creative expression is everything, she said. She was braless in her leotard. Her breasts were small and pert like, if I was a poet, I could have come up with something. I think we have to negate the it, I ventured. We'd smoked a couple of bowls in the bong my plumber friend back in Toledo had made for me. It was industrial, and it was good. I thought I might have gone over the top with that comment about the it, but we were stoned and already over the top, so she nodded as if admiring the view. As if she was afraid she might have missed a reference I was making to some great poet everyone should know. The poet Richard Brautigan was popular then, though he would go on to kill himself like so many of the poets I'd studied. Brodigan once wrote, "All of us have a place in history. Mine is clouds." I guess my comment about the It was in that ballpark, in the cheap seats, but in that ballpark. It seemed like poets had to off themselves to get in the textbook. The most recent entry, John Berryman, had done just that in 1972, making the cut just before the book went to print. He didn't actually cut himself. He jumped off a bridge and missed the fucking Mississippi River. That's all I remember about that class, the dude who flubs his landing. 5. She was from a small town near Black Swamp U, so who could blame her for wanting to be French slash a mime slash a painter? 3 things no one else in her high school would have wanted to be, even in their secret imagination. Her father was a janitor or a gas station attendant named Ronnie. He stopped by her room once in his uniform to drop off a pound cake. She introduced me, but never said what he did. My father made axles in Toledo. More specifically, he welded on axle housing covers, 600 per shift, at the Ford factory. Only Toledo could have an inferiority complex to Detroit. I can say that, having been born and raised there until I was in 8th grade, when my father put in for a transfer to Toledo to try and keep us off the, quote, mean streets of the Motor City. Though, there are mean streets everywhere, even in the Black Swamp region of Ohio. 6. Only Toledo could have an inferiority complex to Detroit, I said. I was drinking Little King's cream ale in their cute little 6-ounce bottles. Maybe we were midgets. He got 35 of them in a case. They were always on sale because what was cream ale anyway? She said something about Monet versus Manet like it was a big-time wrestling match, or maybe I was projecting. Neither of us were good listeners. Her paintings were muddy and abstract. I would study them to try to find one thing that was different from the others. I like that thing in the corner was my cop-out line. You mean that streak of orange? Yeah, that. But I saw myself short, and her short. I brought my ticket to the ballpark, and I was in love with her. She taught me the difference between peasant blouses and pheasant blouses. She was smarter than I was, and at least had some dreams stoking her fire. That reminds me of a dream I had, was another one of my lines, though my dreams were pedestrian. Pedestrians run over by alarm clocks and angry foremen. I liked when she began putting little people in some of her paintings, little people who looked a little lost in the Black Swamp of Ohio. 7. We met in an education class, though neither of us wanted to teach. She thought she might have to do it to get by as an artist. Me, I'd heard it was an easy A, which turned out to be true. After she got me writing poetry, I joined the staff of the Black Swamp Review, a small group of morose stoners who became my friends. Her name was Felicia, and some of the stoners, thinking they were poets, referred to her as Felatio. I let them, for I was getting no Felatio and didn't care to discuss it. We spent our evenings dreaming up new names for the magazine that our studiously dull advisor always rejected. He'd been one of the founders of the magazine back in 1965 and had come up with the name himself. Tui Review. Should we hyphenate that? 2 E's or 3? Intellectual debates punctuated by bong hits. Long, bong, gong, King Kong Review. 8. The only poems I wrote that were not impenetrable were about her. She had long, swirling black hair down her sweet ass and a coy smile that shot my lights out. She was kind and gentle and non-ironic, the last required miming trait. She taught me to eat artichokes, and I nearly lost it watching her scrape leaves with her teeth. I think she loved my hunger for her. It embarrassed and surprised and flattered her. I could not keep my hands off of her. I would go down on her, but she would not reciprocate the not yet review. 9. Time to turn here and take a drink. Through the trees, I can begin to see the rest of my life without her. Our junior year ended and Contradiction went on a tiny tour of tiny Ohio towns. Our gigs were mostly in nursing homes. I went back to Toledo for the summer where my father got me in at Ford's again. As a summer swingman each week, I took the shittiest job of whoever was on vacation, racking up all the overtime I could get, working 7-day weeks to pay for senior year. It was my third summer there, and I quickly fell into the routine. afternoon shift, 3 to 11, the Elke shift. 3 hours to drink after work, time to sleep it off the next morning. The challenge was to find bars where I wouldn't run into my old man. Most of the guys from high school worked at Ford, so half the time it felt like our old gym class locker room. The other half it felt like the detention our principal would have given us if he had been allowed. I reverted, I regressed. Drunk and lonely, I called Felicia from phone booths everywhere. When she asked if I was writing any poetry, I said I was writing contract fiction. She stopped answering. I took a Sunday off, skipping double time, and drove down to Idaho, Ohio. The mime troupe was finishing up its tour in an Episcopal church basement to an appreciative audience of screaming children and their shushing parents. "Why come when they open their mouths, no words come out?" I heard one kid shout. 10. "I'd like to be an astronaut," I once said. "No, you wouldn't." She playfully punched my arm. I'd say anything to get her to punch my arm. "Maybe I'd just like to wear the suit and experience zero gravity. That'd be cool." "Zero gravity," she said. "That's what I'll call my next painting." "You can't," I said. "That's the title of my next poem." Arm punch. Two arm punches equaled one kiss. Led to many kisses. Tickling was tolerated, then into bed. Double O. 11. I had a short shelf life back then. High maintenance. Whatever you want to call it. And it wasn't because of my artistic temperament. I was wasting my time at school, and it made me a little nauseous to think about it. I could never have handled zero gravity myself. My incredulous academic advisor staring at my transcript made me repeat English 3 times when I tried to declare my major. Then I said English education, and he finally nodded and wrote that down. 1977, I had missed Vietnam by a couple of years, though my older brother hadn't. He had died there. I promised myself to be a mime about that, to wave my arms in the air as if shooing away an invisible fly. Some families made a shrine. Some families moved to Toledo and tried to make them disappear. I, the son who lived, had my whole life in front of me, and it looked like one of those muddy paintings, and I was muddy mud hen. 12. "Okay, the home stretch. Just talk to me," my last words to her. "Grow up," her last words to me. At least until the fall, at Tiny Black Swamp, you could not avoid speaking to someone, could not keep a secret, even if you were a mime, even if you were two mimes. Monsieur Contradiction got fired. I never wrote her another poem, but I did send her a picture I drew. Droopy with Beret, I called it. I waited all year for a punch on the arm, and I am still waiting. 13. I knew in advance how stupid it was, but stupidity had never stopped me before. I drove to Ida. They didn't even grow potatoes there. Maybe that's Idaho. It hadn't occurred to me that she might be screwing around with the head mime. I thought he was gay. I had a lot to learn that the factory wasn't teaching me. It was just confirming everything I had already believed. When she saw me in the audience, the O of surprise twisted into a grimace. They did this routine where they were all riding the subway. It was supposed to be improv, but looked scripted to me. There wasn't a subway for hundreds of miles. The French professor wore a beret during the show and after the show. He'd had a beret surgically implanted. And Felicia wanted so badly to eat good bread and picnic in a field of poppies on an actual hill in France, just like in that painting above her bed at Black Swamp View. Deep inside, I felt a little sympathy for both of them. That doesn't mean I didn't briefly choke him, because I did. Such an undoobie thing to do, but I was in musculus axel modus. She tried to wedge herself between us, and despite my rage, I felt one of her breasts poke softly beneath my arm, stiff against his neck. I was hopeless. I slept in my car, then drove back to punch in on time, even a little early. I stood outside the factory gates having a smoke, the one thing I had in common with artists. Though even I could do the ones where the walls were closing in. Okay, so that's a story. And now I'm going to read you a few poems and see where that goes. As I said, I've been teaching a long time, and so I have been writing some poems about teaching. And this poem is called Mega Everything, and it's a poem that started out and Tom kind of explained this, but one of my students turned in a Black Sabbath lyrics and claimed that he had written them, that it was his own poem. And my initial reaction was that, oh, I was proud that one, that I recognized Black Sabbath lyrics. And then, two, it just made an easy joke with my colleagues, the other faculty members. Can you believe that this kid turned Black Sabbath lyrics in as his own poem? But then, I started thinking and remembering myself when I was kind of close to his age, and remembering a Black Sabbath concert that I went to, and how I wasn't a very well put together kid myself back then. So this poem was back and forth from confronting this kid in my office to this concert when I was a young teenager. And the poem has a quote at the beginning, some of those deep, profound Black Sabbath lyrics. These are from War Pigs. Generals gathered in their masses, just like witches at black masses, evil minds that plot destruction, sorcerer of death's construction. Last thing I should mention, because some of you are younger, and I don't know if you have done your Black Sabbath historical research, but one of the famous, probably the most famous thing Ozzy Osbourne has claimed to have done is that he bit off the head off a bat in a concert. Some of you know that? Okay. So I'm glad you know your history, because that shows up later. Mega everything. The kid with stringy blonde hair and torn Megadeth t-shirt plagiarized song lyrics in his poem. Black Sabbath, I said. In my tiny gray office, he idly kicked the metal desk, not meeting my eyes, though he never did. 1972, Michigan State Fairgrounds. Black Sabbath ripped through the sharp muffle of Paranoid on the distant stage while I guzzled malt liquor from quart bottles on a gloomy Saturday afternoon. Ozzy stalking on stage scared me in a familiar Detroit way, like a biker gang crashing a high school party. I shook it off. I raised my fist. The kid said turning in the lyrics was a test but would go no further. Had I passed, those lyrics, the only semi-coherent thing he turned in all term. He could have fooled me with Megadeth lyrics, and perhaps he had. We agreed that he should drop. He hesitated at the door like there might be one more thing. 16, my ears buzzed with dark star feedback, barking dogs, bloody teeth, fragments of a thorough ass-kicking. Ozzy's wire cutter rasp asked, what happened when we died and where exactly was the soul? When the thunderstorm arced down on us, no one fled. We stood and took it. Poetry was all I had that wasn't toxic. I should have been easier on the kid. His name was Chris. He slumped away, black boots clomping against the floor, and I never saw him again. The bitter mascara of the unrepentant and the flawed jewel of self-absorption. Ozzy's damaged now beyond coherence. He hadn't yet bitten the head off a bat when I saw him in 72. He only had to do it once. The rest of us, Chris, we think about it every day under the black, incoherent moon. And for some of you, maybe poetry can be the thing that isn't toxic in your life, when everything else seems kind of toxic. Oh, so then I kind of organize this reading into groups. And this poem references another historic event in rock and roll history, which is when Jimi Hendrix lit his guitar on fire at the Monterey Pop Festival. Now, if you've never seen this, you should YouTube it. It had a big impact on us back in this class. So sometimes I write poems because no one believes that things really happen. And in a poem, it can happen or not happen. But my high school did offer a course called Outdoor Chef. And so this is kind of explaining what kind of high school would offer a course called Outdoor Chef, which I took. Nobody believes my high school offered a class called Outdoor Chef. The yearbook carried a picture of us firing up the barbecue in the parking lot. This was before the invention of the gas grill, before they raised the drinking age back to 21. Jimi Hendrix burned his guitar at Monterey and died shortly after, bumming us out in Outdoor Chef. It was only a one semester course, so we had to cram. Charcoal lighter was routinely abused. We spelled our names on the sidewalk and lit them like pissing in snow. Our teacher was Mrs. Reynolds, enormous and cheerful, and in retrospect, willfully ignorant and alcoholic. It was a difficult class to teach, no textbook. Mr. Farwell, our principal, needed higher graduation rates, courses to shunt problem kids into. Now, one fight in Outdoor Chef, despite having the toughest guys in the school bunched together around the grills. Class was often outside, even in winter. Class was often cut, long, wild hair disappearing in the snow toward the parking lot. Joints often snaked between us, smoke blending with burning meat. I learned a lot about cooking chicken and pork. See, those are important things. You can get sick not cooking them long enough and make others sick too. Neighbors would never come over for a cookout again. My apron had some crude joke about a hot dog on it. So did everyone else's. I can't begin to express how clever we were. We cooked a whole turkey for Thanksgiving and served it to Mr. Farwell and Mr. Stark, the assistant principal slash hitman. He said he could have used a course like that when he was in school. They did not get sick. It was a festive occasion until we let a live turkey loose in the main hallway. No girls in Outdoor Chef, though. You might have guessed that. The jocks were subdued and serious about remaining eligible. Our school had few jocks to spare. The rest of us were lighting each other's long hair on fire and thinking that was a fine joke. Okay, Eddie Bucco did get stabbed with a skewer, but we all agreed it was an accident. We enjoyed waving our hands above the hot coals. None of us bothered with winter gloves. The last day of class, Jackie Smoker brought in his cheap electric guitar and tried to imitate Hendrix, blasting from his nearby car radio. He messed up his hands bad, but for a while, it was beautiful. Even now, I'm full of self-mockery and loathing. The truth was that for many of us, having our own barbecue would indicate a successful life. Mrs. Reynolds had gone to college to teach home ec. We should have treated her better, her and everybody else. Yes, it's on my transcript with a C. Our final had some math on it. The wind blew ash and smoke into the air, just like at the factory down the road. We had to provide our own briquettes. There's an enormous number of things you can cook outdoors. The only class in which we believed what the teacher told us, because we could see that in gym class. We chewed gum outside and threw it against the school building. Mr. Farwell gave most of us diplomas. I don't know how many years Outdoor Chef was offered. You could not burn your marshmallow on the test. That, when all we wanted was to go up in flames. That's my high school. Now, since we were talking about cooking hamburgers, this poem is about hot dogs. It's called Hot Dog Variations, and I think the hot dog is a food that doesn't get enough respect, so I'm trying to redeem it a little bit. It's like an ode to hot dogs. Hot Dog Variations. I stuck potato sticks into my bun and called it a porcupine. They scraped my palate into bleeding. My mother wrapped dogs in bacon, slipped aside for a sliver of pickle, and called them gourmet. A 2-for-1 coupon from 7-Eleven. They circled black on a spit under a pale bulb and came back up on the swings in the park. 3 a.m., and we wanted to have sex again. Downstairs, I boiled the dogs. We wrapped them in white bread. We nearly choked. I ate them cold from the package, rehearsing my speech about purity on long-distance drug deliveries for Mad Mike. God save the hot dog, its wobble, its cushion fall into the bun. God bless American condiments and baked beans. It fell in the dirt, but I wiped it on my jeans. It fell in the coals, but I wiped it on my jeans. It fell off the platter, and I fought the dog for it. I fought the dog, and the dog won. Relish in love, madness and mustard. Don't choke, don't wince when you bite into something hard. Grind it up and don't grumble, don't mumble. Lord, it comes spilling out the side. Chili and onions and regret. Wipe the corner of your mouth. Grin like a good American. Grin and don't hit anyone. Grin and load up the grill. Grin and click the tongs like a hungry gator. Cheap paper plates sticking together like pure love. Eat with your hands in a hurry. Eat when you're poor, when you don't give a you just want to gulp it down, get back to it. And I want to read a poem about my brother Mike. And actually, I'm going to read an old poem and then a new poem, which kind of deals with the same thing. Because, like I said, I'm kind of moving in pairs here. So my first book, published in 1985, I wrote this poem called Wheels, which my brother, he's a truck driver for Chrysler. And he's had more cars, more trucks, more motorcycles than any human being that I know. And so it's, and he has pictures of all these vehicles. And so up in his garage, and it occurred to me that it kind of told his life story. At least the important things in his version of his life story. So I wrote this poem called Wheels. My brother kept in a frame on the wall pictures of every motorcycle, car, truck, in his rusted out Impala convertible wearing his cap and gown, waving, in his yellow Barracuda with a girl leaning into him, waving, on his Honda 350, waving, on his Honda 750 with the boys holding a beer, waving, in his first wig wearing a baseball hat backward, waving, in his murky Montego getting married, waving, in his black LTD trying to sell real estate, waving, back to driving trucks, a shiny new rig, waving, on his Harley Sportster with his wife on the back, waving, his son in a car seat with his own steering wheel, my brother leaning over him in an old Ford pickup, and they are waving, holding a wrench, a rag, a hose, a chamois, waving, my brother helmetless rides off in his Harley, waving, my brother's feet barely touch the ground, waving, waving, face pressed to the wind, no camera to save him. So I read this poem in a high school once, and a kid said, does that mean your brother died at the end of the poem? And I said, oh, no, no, the poem is supposed to be about just the fact that the picture sort of preserved him, like any picture preserves any of us, but as soon as he was in motion, he was in danger. And I kind of sort of laughed it off. But then more recently, he did almost die in a motorcycle accident. He was hit by a car, as you'll see in the poem itself. So I thought I would read this. It's funny, you write a poem about something, and then real life sort of intrudes and makes you, at least it made me see this poem in a different way. So this this poem is called One Word. There should be this page. And actually, this he had the accident on the road, and so it wasn't close to home, so we had to make these sort of long trips up to the hospital to visit him. And for a long time, it was dicey, and he was in a coma, so there was this mystery of whether, you know, if he was going to wake up and how much of him was going to be there in terms of, you know, brain trauma. One word. My brother lies in his hospital bed, steeped in the clammy smell of the almost dead. Stitches hang stiff under his chin, a scraggly Fu Manchu they sewed on him fresh off life flight. His motorcycle mangled by a 16-year-old running a stop sign. My brother is simply trying to speak, to push out a single word. The breathing tube's been removed. We thought when it came out, he'd be telling us he's going to be all right, or at least where it hurts. But his brain still spun, weaving a fuzzy web. We're bent over, smelling the pain at his lips, so close those stitches prick. He's making a noise something like the Tin Man, But he's not saying, oil me. He's not saying, what? Listen, come on, try again. It's more than a groan and less than satisfactory. Like the slow-mo grunt of a tennis player, so jazzed up he can't just hit it and keep quiet. Like the door to the principal's office swinging open for you. Come on, open your eyes, just one eye. A sound like grating breadcrumbs, an oral afterthought unfinished, the squeaky chair you squirm in, a dud firework. 6 days and they haven't given him a bath. He reeks, his thing's beeping again. Where's the nurse? And wait, we love you, can you hear us? It's less than a whistle and more than maddening. The tin man's full clumsy rattling dance. That dude's going, ah, so why not us? We all have hearts. Brother, we'll make you a deal with the damn witch. Trade her some of your neat handwriting and good manners. Broomstick, slippers, a package deal for a little translation, a little more wet space between dry lips for sound to slip out. Anything, anything. My eyes closed, concentrating on the subtle rise and fall of what are less than syllables, but more than random. Oh, my brother, we're laying the torches and heading out into the darkness to find the words and bring them back to you. A couple of poems. I'm going to jump forward because I really haven't read anything about the other side of things, which is, you know, being a parent. And so I'm going to read a couple poems about my children, in one form or another. And this is advice for all future parents. And it's called, If You Ever Have to Do This Yourself. There was a time when my wife was away and we went to the school carnival. And this occurred. If you ever have to do this yourself. My daughter started crying when she couldn't get the fake poop back into the fake butt of the pooping dog she won at the school carnival. She'd squeezed too hard and the poop popped out. I was driving home. We'd eaten half-frozen fries and gristly hot dogs, all for a good cause. She's in first grade, my son's in third. His dog still has its poop. She doesn't want me to say potty anymore, too babyish, yet she was bawling. And I lost it, yelling loud enough to scare us all. Back home, I got them in the bed, my daughter still snuffling, my son glazed over into silence. Shame. I stood in the kitchen, jamming the orange rubber cylinder of poop back up the plastic dog's butt. I used index finger, I used thumb, I used tack hammer. I wet the poop, then squeezed with needle-nose pliers until I got it all back in. Two pooping dogs and a counter for them to find the next morning, to write their names on in Sharpie marker. They kissed me when I awoke. They held their puppies. We have no pets, though they're always asking. If you ever have to do this yourself, keep it together. Shut up and do love's dirty work. The things you do. And this is a poem somebody asked me to read that I haven't read in a while. That it's a good thing to remember when, because my kids are around. They're both in college, so they're around your age. I'm sure they're the same age as some of you. And there's this kind of magic of when they're really young that I try to capture in this poem, which is called Beautiful Thing. My first child collects snail shells under a sun the color of the shirt before the blood, rinsing them like a priest washing his hands before the miracle. He raises each white shell for me to admire. I wash my face with his soft skin, the wetness and the glow. He is a pure guitar string echoing in the shell of the hollow body where someone lived once, then left this beautiful thing. Imagine the sound. And I just have two more poems and I'll finish up here. One's a short poem and the other's a longer poem. We're getting into colder weather here, and I'm sure anyone who's come from around here, probably made a snow angel at some time in your life. That maybe still kind of fun to make. But I never really closely examined the snow angel until this particular occasion. I had this great insight that I'm going to share with you. The poem is called The Fall. Tonight, I look down from the upstairs window at the snow angel I fell to make in the yard, now lit by moonlight, glistening. What glorious wings. What a tiny head. See, because, you know, your head just makes this little dent. It's this one. Oh, it landed in an embarrassing place. Okay, so the last poem I want to read comes back to family, and one of the things that I'm dealing with and actually exploring in various ways is dealing with aging parents. My parents are 86, and we're really in the thick of it in terms of health issues and trying to figure out what to do with them. So it's been on my mind a lot, and it's been a struggle. So I wanted to read this poem about my parents after they retired, but when they were, and my mother had some health problems even then, but these days are clearly behind them. So in this poem, there's a couple things you need to know. And again, we were such stupid kids. So I was one of five kids in a three-bedroom house. My grandmother, my sister was lucky. She shared a room with my grandmother. That was a good time. And then we had four boys, two bunk beds in a tiny room. And then my parents had a room, and they were all boom, boom, boom. So they didn't have a heck of a lot of privacy. I don't know how they found the time to make five kids. But the code for my parents having sex that we didn't decipher until we were all grown-ups sitting around drinking on some family occasion was that they said that my mother was going to give my father a back rub and that we had to leave them alone. It seems pretty obvious that would be, we get it, but no, okay, back rub. Two other things in this poem is, one is my mother has steel rods in the back. She has scoliosis, and it's a real mess, and that shows up here. And the thing was that I got engaged to be married when I was around your age, and fortunately we did not get married, because that would have been just one more disaster in my life. The title of this poem is called The Sound of It, and it's one of those titles that I hope when I get to the end of the poem, the title will make sense. And again, thank you all for coming. Thanks to the club and to Dan. It's been great to be here. And I'm around, and we're going to talk afterwards, right? Okay. The sound of it. When my mother gave my father a back rub in their bedroom, we had to turn up the TV and behave. We offered to give him back rubs. He claimed it wasn't the same. I got engaged when I was 19, $300 ring from the mall jeweler. When she went on vacation with her family, I kept a pair of her panties under the front seat of my car. After we broke up, I could still talk her into a back rub now and then, shamelessly invoking history like some pompous prime minister. She disappeared with an old friend of mine. Not old enough, yeah. My back gets a little sore just thinking about it. My mother has steel rods in her back now. She can't bend at the waist. They sleep in separate rooms so they don't keep each other up. I sold the ring for $50. The jeweler said he was giving me a deal, that I paid for the setting, not the gold. They'd melt it down, reuse the diamond. My mother stored condoms in her jewelry box. Once I unrolled them and called them finger gloves, I filled them with water at the sink. She didn't say a word. She was cooking dinner. It all melts down again, even the steel in my mother's back. We are all still alive somewhere, metal detectors going off as we step through our lives. I wish they could still escape into that tiny room, one bed squeaking. When I'm having back trouble, the doctor tells me, oh, backs are funny, as if that explained everything. Rank your pain on a scale from 1 to 10. That girl is in her 50s now, like me. She had beautiful breasts, though I'm not sure I ever told her so. They're called massages now, Perhaps that sounds more soothing. From behind, I saw my parents hold hands last year, my mother leaning against her cane with her other hand. They were walking down a path toward a waterfall. The sound of it drowned out everything. Thank you.
Questions, feel free.
If you
just raise your hand and ask anything you like.
You don't ask any questions, I'm just going to spill this water all over myself. All right. Anybody? Yes?
I was wondering, in my poetry class, you just read Bernhardt, and a lot of your poems are written in sections, and I was wondering what inspires you to do that, and how do you get to a place where you can kind of jump around, but bring everything back together?
Okay. Did you hear that over here? Sometimes I forget. I'm the only one who hears the question. So, sections. I think part of it is how I started writing fiction from poetry, and in terms of expanding things out. And there was a quote from the writer and politician Vaclav Havel, who's dead now, but he was a playwright, was a political prisoner in Czechoslovakia, who ended up being the first president of the Free Czech Republic, freely elected democratic guy. And he was brilliant. I mean, if you read any of his political speeches, you say, oh, this guy actually knows how to talk and write a speech that's genuine. Anyway, there was a book of interviews with him called Disturbing the Peace. And he said that a writer around age 35, and this can vary widely, but I think you reach a crucial point. You can either repeat what you've done up until that point that's gotten you whatever success that you've gotten, or you can take a crucial step into something new. And I was around 35 back when I read it, and I Xeroxed it and taped it above my desk, because a lot of my early poems and some of the ones I read today are just are these short, straightforward narratives. And one of the things you may have noticed, those of you I think they're taking poetry classes, I don't have a lot of similes and metaphors in my work. But that's not exactly a deliberate choice. I wish they would jump in a little more, but my brain doesn't quite function that way. I admire poets who are able to do that. So I got the idea, in terms of moving forward, that in a simile or metaphor, I don't want to sound like an English professor here, even though I am. So the further away two things are in the comparison, like if I say a basketball is like a bowling ball without holes, you're not going to say, oh, wow, that's deep, right? So the further away the two things are being compared, often the greater insight there is. So I said, well, yeah, I'm writing these narrative things, and I could probably just keep writing them for the rest of the, you know, and maybe getting them published and stuff. But what if I take this idea of the metaphor and instead have two stories going on simultaneously at the same time? And often, to do that, I break them into sections, like in the Mega Everything poem. So I'm telling two stories at the same time and alternating the sections. So that's one of the ways I got into writing a section. And actually making these small independent films that none of you will ever see helped me in terms of, because films do that all the time, jump cuts. You know, you'll be somewhere, and they'll just jump somewhere completely different. And we kind of accept that when we're watching a movie. As a writer, you need to put a little asterisk in for a number, and then we're able to jump. But that's kind of where that came from. Other questions? Yes?
You were just talking about the independent films that you've made and such. I want to ask, because I'm interested in both poetry and script writing personally, and I want to hear your thoughts on what it was like being both a poet and a script writer. I think it was mentioned earlier in the event that you've had produced screenplays before, and what are sort of the relationships between writing poetry and writing for scripts? Like, if you could talk about that a bit.
Yeah, no, that's a very good question. I'll try and make two points about that. One is how they're different, and one's how they're similar. How they're different is that, and a lot of you are taking writing classes, when we write, we go in little rooms by ourselves, and we're alone, and it's often not a lot of fun. It's not a social activity. Later, maybe we share our work with other people, but they call it in the Wonder Boys, the midnight disease or something, where there is a kind of isolation inherent in the process. The filmmaking process is collaborative, and for me as a writer, that's really stimulating to be around creative people, creative actors. So my role in these films is kind of director, producer, though I do everything from editing to making sure people get fed and stocking cars so they don't come into the shot and stuff like that. But the sound people, because we have somebody doing a score. We have no money. We call it the no-budget films, essentially, because I was kind of shocked to hear that at Sundance Film Festival, the average budget is $1 million. And we're trying to get like one more zero onto our budget, which would still leave us a couple of zeros away from there. But it's a collaborative, creative energy that you have to check your ego at the door and be willing to change things because everyone contributes. But I like that because people come up with things I would not have thought of and they're talented in other ways. But the scariest thing about these films is casting because, so I have my script and me and the director will be sitting there and an actor who maybe is not very good will read the part and I'll say, man, who wrote that? Oh yeah, I did. I mean, it sounds so horrible and unconvincing that it messes with my confidence, but then someone will come in and nail it, and I just realize how much they can add. Now the similarity, because the film I'm working on right now, like I have a version of it on my laptop that we send it back and forth to each other and suggest edits, but there's no dialogue at all. There's maybe two or three words spoken, but really no dialogue. And that's more, it's an adaptation of a poem into a film. And the connection for me is that they rely so heavily on the visual image. So yeah, you have dialogue, but you're looking at something the whole time. And the visual image in a film, like if something were on the screen, that would really dominate. Nobody would be listening to me. I mean, you might be listening slightly, but your eyes would be on this big image. And in poetry, when you're selling things, you're selling it with the image that maybe size-wise is just the size of a 12-point type, but has the impact. A good, strong image, that cliche of pictures worth 1,000 words is a cliche because it's kind of true, both in poetry and in film. So those are a couple things that attract me to it, and the similarities and differences. Yes, right behind you.
Do you believe in censorship in poetry? Because we talk about that in our class. Like, have you ever written about a subject and kind of feared that they would see it and criticize it or be upset, or do you just write whatever?
Who's they?
The people you write about, your subjects. I don't know.
Okay, yeah. Well, there is that in terms of family. So most cases I change the names, except in one case where I wanted to make a point to my friend and I used his real name. And I put in parentheses real name just to make sure that everyone knew. he took it well. But so every time my first book continues to be an issue. So I send my book to my family, and then the reviews come in, and they're often based on what really happened and what didn't. So I have a poem called "My Mother's See-Through Blouse" that I wrote. So my sister calls me up. She says, "Now, Mom says she never had a blouse like that." And for me, it doesn't matter. I mean, I kind of remember it, but it's not a defense of the poem. I tell my writing students, the truth is no excuse for a bad poem. I mean, the poem has to generate its own truth. So when that first book was accepted, I published all these poems in literary magazines. Love my family, but they're not reading literary magazines, right? So I was publishing them anonymously, essentially. And then I won this prize, and this book was coming out. I was all excited, and I said, uh-oh. So I dedicated the book to them, thinking that would help. And then I had to kind of say that it's true, poetry is fiction, it's not nonfiction. And that, so, for, and I have a number of poems, because I tend to come back to the same subjects, about my father not being around when we were growing up, because he's working so much overtime, like the thing I read at the beginning, I keep writing about it. And my father, like he once said when we were on vacation, when my brother said he wasn't spending enough quality time with his son, my dad said, "Well, I never spent any quality time with any of you, and you turned out okay." So he realizes that that's a fact that we both kind of regret. And so he understands that, yeah, I may change some of the facts of it. Like I have a poem where he has a stroke, and then, but he didn't really have a stroke. The guy across the street had a stroke. So some people in like the old neighborhood won't kind of get confused because they haven't really read much poetry. And in Birthmarks, there's a poem called My Two Aunts that I withheld from a couple of books because I was waiting for my alcoholic uncles to die, quite frankly, because I felt like that was a position that my immediate family, you know, I know they're going to deal with it, but with my aunts and uncles and stuff, I felt like, I can't do that, but, so I waited. Now, I was trying to change the title to like My Two Friends or My Two Whatever, but it didn't work. It had to be My Two Aunts, and so I didn't censor it. I just waited to get it out there. And I actually kind of pushed things in terms of, like there's a poem called Explicit in one of the books that's, I probably don't even want to describe what it's about, but it's very explicit. But it's deliberate to say, well, hey, can I write a poem about this that's not going to be overwhelmed by people being disgusted with it? And the jury's out, but you know, I'll give it a shot. Okay. Other questions? Yeah, if you start censoring yourself, then you're limiting yourself as a writer. I mean, you can do stuff for shock value, but it's like fireworks. You go to see the fireworks, 4th of July, and everyone says, ooh and ah, and they go home. But the next day, most people aren't saying, oh, remember that one firework? The third one, you know, wasn't that a great firework? It's all in the moment. And you don't want your poems to be like that, where they have these arbitrary explosions, but there's nothing here going on. Fireworks tend not to hit you in here. It's just the dazzle. Okay, a couple other questions. Yes?
Do you feel as though certain subjects that you write about tend to lead themselves towards, like Kayla was saying, split poems with different like stanzas and different sections to them, like Foundation?
Yeah. Foundation is a good example. That's a longer poem. I think the older I get, the more the subject matter tends to break up like that. And I think because you have these sort of parallel experiences that you can play off each other at different ages. And right now, I'm in this in-between zone between being a parent and being a child, and now the whole thing that happens for a lot of people, we're starting to kind of be parents to our parents, and my children are adults, so I'm often going back and forth between those two places in my work right now. But yeah, I do think the subjects that I write about tend to, they're simultaneous narratives. Maybe one more question? Okay, and I'll be around for individual conversation afterwards, but I know other people have places to go. But is there a last question that you're, yes.
Okay. In my poetry course, we read Birthmarks, and we read Lip Gloss Belgium, and we all kind of sat around debating how that poem kind of came about. So I'm wondering if you could clarify.
I don't know. That's a weird poem.
Yeah.
I don't know if I can clarify because it was more of a stream of consciousness kind of poem. And I do write these other kinds of poems to try and find a place for them in my work. So I will just read this poem and end with it. And I'll try and think of something. Well, I can talk about the inspiration for this poem, which is my frustration with bureaucracy. And which tends to come up all the time. And you know, when you're calling to complain about something and you can't get a real person, and you know, just this arbitrary enforcement of the rules that makes no sense, and you just want to say, can I get a human being that can explain this? That versus the imagination, I guess, is and where the imagination can take us. There are a couple of poems in here that deal with like mail. The poem about the letter and how, you know, the letter's disappearing. Lip Gloss Belgium, which it doesn't have anything to do with Belgium. The phone company sent me 6 bills, postage 44 cents each, to tell me I owed 26 cents. Then they sent a bill saying I owed $6.26. When I called to object, I was phone menued to a new dial tone. I borrow my neighbor's dog for runs in the park just to be able to hand back the leash and walk away. My daughter pulls on my hair to make sure I'm not a witch. She cried when I beat her at ping pong. The computer's red thing just underlined that. I'm supposed to capitalize ping pong. Red thing itself wants to be capitalized too. A train runs under my chair and crashes into my foot. I wish I'd grown up in Ping Pong, Wisconsin, or Hyphen, Missouri. My daughter's been studying the phrases of the moon. Red thing didn't catch that one. My favorite is Duffed Hither. My hair is not falling out, just stiffening white. I tried to keep the game close, but that made it worse. I would have happily lost. The soul is the size of a ping pong ball with the consistency of Jell-O. Capital J? It's lit by a wick formed with the letters of the first lie. The world says I owe it 26 cents to send it care of Red Thing, Alabama. Maybe Red Thing should just underline lies. I was born before lip gloss was invented. I used to use an ink eraser manufactured in Oxymoron, New Jersey. I believe the soul of the nun who was my 6th grade teacher was made of that exact same material. My daughter is asleep now. Someone is calling a dog, but the dog isn't coming. It could be dinner time or bath time. We'll never know. Or maybe when we die and our bodies are taken to Lip Gloss Belgium, we find out. Or else we meet some boring asshole who keeps insisting we call it table tennis. When the moon's last dark smudge becomes light, like a ping pong ball rising off the table toward the basement spiky rafters, nearly anything could happen. All right, thanks.